Hello, everyone. Welcome to Ion Entertainment. And today, our very special guest is my great friend and great actor, Robert Amico.
Hi. Hi, Dawna.
Well, you know, we've been trying to set this up for a while, and we have something very special to promote today, the film Bad President. But first, I want to start at the beginning. So tell us how you grew up. Tell us about your family,
where you were born. I grew up lower middle class Italian family in Brooklyn, New York.
Okay, great.
There were children everywhere, but we were very poor. It was all row housing. So it was very interesting childhood. Tons of kids to play with, but I didn't know I was poor till I became a teenager.
That's great. Well, what did your parents do?
My father was a laborer and my mother was a stay-home housewife. And then when they needed money, she would work part-time. And I didn't initially start off very young as an actor. I actually was very fascinated with engineering because I have a very mathematical mind. I mean, in my year of graduating high school, I was the only one in all of the United States that got a perfect score, 800 out of 800 on the mathematical part of the SATs.
Well, that's why you're such a great producer then. Okay, but
I just went creative. I'm a musician since I'm 6 years old. I play guitar. In the last year and a half, I play 3 hours every day without missing a day. I've had rock bands that I've performed and composed, and I've been an actor since I'm 17.
Okay, so, well, do you have brothers and sisters?
I have a baby sister who has passed on.
Oh, okay.
That was a rough one. And my mom and dad have passed away.
Okay.
So I'm an orphan.
How did you get into acting?
How did I get into acting? Well, I didn't get into acting to do acting. When I'm going to try and shorten this part of the whole story up, but I was a very young hippie at 15. I was very liberated. I used to spend my whole weekends at Timothy Leary Millbrook, upstate New York, and hang out with all beat poets, Ginsberg. And I was very, very shy. And there were tons of hippie girls running around naked. And I was a virgin and my hormones were raging, but I was very shy. I couldn't even talk to a girl. I used to bug Timothy Leary and Andy Warhol about all that and that I wanted to not be a virgin anymore. And then one day I was with Timothy, Andy Warhol, I think it was Lou Reed. I don't know if you know who Lou Reed was, the song Walk on the Wild Side.
Yeah.
And myself, and I'm sitting in a cafe, which is still there, Cafe Kiev, in the Lower East Village in New York. I'm 17 years old, hanging out with them, having lunch. And who comes walking in but Lee Strasberg with a few people. And Andy saw him and called him over because he thought that's the way to get over my shyness, take acting classes. And he told Lee that he should put me in his class at Carnegie Hall. So Lee Strasberg just looked me up and down and went, okay, come Thursday night.
Okay, tell us about, okay, so you went through Lee Strasberg's Ask Actor Studio.
Yeah, I studied the method at Carnegie Hall at 17.
Okay.
And had Al Pacino in my class for a while, went over to Actor's Studio. Paul Newman was kind of my mentor there. I had some great actors in my class that would come in and out of that class, like Eli Wallach,
Wow.
and Al Pacino, and then I did some plays. I got my SAG card on a pilot of Kojak. Who loves you, baby? And then I was getting married. I was engaged to be married, very young, 20 years old. And she was very jealous of my music and my acting, so I gave it up to get married. And
Well,
went back to my engineering and got a corporate job and had 600 people under me. And it was so funny because Lee Strasberg had gotten me the Fredo role in The Godfather, and I turned it down because I was getting married.
because of your
So that was a whole other thing that went on. And I just gave up everything. I left Lee's class. I didn't act. I sold my guitars and I did a corporate job. And then we broke up years later. I one day went to work at 9:26 in the morning to my corporate job with 600 people under me. And I quit to go back to my acting. And drive a cab in New York, and then did a lot of nothing but theater in New York for about 5 or 6 years. Did some independent films, but back then there wasn't a lot of work in New York. And then I saw that Spielberg was doing Hook, so I sent him a letter, and he actually called me up and asked me if I would be one of the pirates in Hook. So that brought me out here where the work was more abundant, for sure. And that's how I got to LA. I've been here since the 1990. And I worked 4 months on Hook, did a couple of publicity things for that, and just got my career going here. I mean, I was always a theater, but I did over 60 plays in New York and LA. So all the stuff that I did previous was catching up, like Near Myth, The Oscar Knight Story, which I
Yeah,
sent
because of
Renee a clip from. That's coming out real soon. That's a beautiful film. I have a great role in it. And then next week, premiering Hollywood.com with Tom Arnold and Brian Cruz and Mika Boerum, who directed, is coming out on Amazon Prime. And then, of course, you and I in Bad President
Yes, well,
with Eddie Griffin.
Robert, you're always working, and I know you know everyone in
Yeah, I
Hollywood.
say that about you. You're always working. I call you
Well,
up and
because
you're
you
like, I'm in Chicago, I'm in Spain, I'm in Israel. And me, I'm just like in South LA, North LA, Santa Clarita.
well, tell us, okay, now we know, tell us about your guest stars on TV, because to me, that is really impressive because I know how hard it is to get on network TV.
Yeah, that's hard, but I don't have a big TV career. I'm more independent films. Well, CSI was great.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That was great. And how I got on that is, I really don't know. I really don't know, but I could tell you, my agent almost blew it. So I fired my agent. But what happened was, I pick up the phone and it's the executive producer and creator of CSI. And he goes, if I write a role for you, will you do it? And I said, there's a wild bear poop in the woods. Of course I'll do it. So he goes, okay, let me work on the script. It's gonna have a 4-episode arc, but your storyline is the whole season, even though you're not in every episode. It's about you. So I go, yeah, knock yourself out. About 4 weeks later, I get a call from my agent saying, you have a meeting on Tuesday morning at 9 a.m. over at Warner Brothers with the creator and executive producer of CSI. You have the role. He just wants to see that you have no tattoos on your face and you have two arms and two legs and two eyes and can talk. And just, so he just wants a meet and greet and sign contracts. I said, great, 9 a.m. at Warner Brothers. Go to Warner Brothers Producers Building, 9 a.m. on Tuesday. And I'm looking around and it's real quiet and there's nobody anywhere except for this young secretary. And she goes, oh, hello, can I help you? And I go, yeah, I have a meeting with so-and-so. And she goes, you do? He has no meetings today. I said, what do you mean? I have a meeting 9 a.m. She goes, what's your name? I said, Robert Amico. She goes, oh. I go, what do you mean? Oh. She goes, Your meeting was yesterday, Monday, and you didn't show up. And he, the whole set was waiting for him to come back. They couldn't shoot CSI, and he is really, really pissed at you. I said, what? I said, my agent told me Tuesday. Well, your agent got it wrong. I said, is he in? He goes, yeah, but he doesn't want to talk to you. I said, please, this is all on my agent, and it has nothing to do with me and my integrity. I'm a very integrous person, and I would never do this. So she, okay, call him. So she tells him, he says, okay, you can go in. He'll give you a minute. So I go in, and we wound up talking, and he realized that it wasn't on me, and I got the role.
Oh, that's well, that's
And the role
good.
was very interesting. I had to go into a place and have a whole full body cast done of me. And a lot of people can do that. I've done that a couple of times, and you'd be amazed how many stars can't do that because you can't even move your cheek muscles. You can't even, you have to breathe very shallow, and you got two straws up your thing, and your head is in plaster, and your whole body's in plaster. You start to hear your heartbeat, you start to freak out, get anxiety. It was I did a movie for the first movie for the Sci-Fi Channel. And I had to do a body cast, and the stars of the movie at the time couldn't do it. They kept ripping the thing off, and then they quit the film. And they had to get new stars for the film. So I had to do that. I had to go in for that because there's a scene with me and Marg from CSI, but it's not really me. It's a body cast of me on the morgue's lab. And she's like looking at my body and cutting it open. So, that was for that. And then I had to do two photo shoots, and then I had to come in and do a scene with Joe Bologna. So I was in like four episodes, but the basic storyline was there was a serial killer who went around killing people in revenge. And with me, I was the first one. And what he did was he cut me open and tied my intestines in a bow.
Okay,
And the whole storyline was Lawrence Fishburne was on the show at the time. And Lawrence Fishburne was obsessed with finding out who my killer was. And my scenes were all like flashback. I was a glitzy in the 70s and 60s Dean Martin's piano player in Vegas. So I like there's a scene of me in a flashback with a tux playing piano, and it was kind of cool. I made so I'm still making. I just got a trip yesterday for $20 on those episodes. I wound up making like $14,000.
that's
Yeah, I
great.
love TV. Residuals are great, but I don't do much TV. I do independent films, and
Okay,
a
well,
couple
tell
like
us.
Hook. I did Demolition Man with Sylvester Stallone, but I got cut out of the whole film. Yeah, he broke two of my ribs in the film accidentally.
Okay,
He
what
punched me
film
in the
was
ribs.
that? What film was this? I'm sorry.
Demolition Man.
Oh.
Demolition Man with
Okay.
Sly.
And so you
There's a
had two
scene where we had a
broken.
fight. See, it was like that scene was in the future, and he's like a cop in the future, and he catches me trying to rob a car, and I rob the car, and he chases me, and I crash the car, and he pulls me out of the car, and we fight.
That's
But
great.
he didn't do the choreography right, and so he hit me in the ribs. But I didn't tell anybody my ribs. I just went home and broke a rib and taped it because I've had broken ribs before and there's nothing you can do. So I just went on with the shooting. And then the next scene, he did the wrong choreography and walked into my punch and I split his lip. And that was the end of shooting. I thought I'd never work again in this business, but he was cool. He's like, oh, you robbed me. It's okay, man. It's good. It's all right. You did good, kid. You did good.
Oh, that's
So
great. Okay,
that was a fun
tell
day.
us
That was a
what
fun
those
day.
trophies behind you are for. The trophies behind you?
These are Telly Awards, and this one is for me directing and producing with my production company, Life Imitates Art. It's a Telly Award. Johnny Carson won 20 of these. Isn't it beautiful?
Yeah,
It
it's
weighs about
beautiful.
10 pounds.
Yeah, it is
As a matter
beautiful.
of fact, I'm up for one now with the Chains That Bind. It's just finishing up its film festival run that I direct, and I have a tiny role in. It's a beautiful film. That's it's going to be at the Vegas Film Festival coming up. And this one is that was 2000. That was the first film I ever directed. That's how I started directing and producing.
Okay.
Now I have 45 films I produced or was a producer on. This one's for A Miss, 2016. A Miss is a beautiful little short film that wound up going to all the film festivals that was a 24-hour film festival. I had to go in to meet with them. 22 people took the challenge on. I had to go in on 8 o'clock p.m. on a Friday and pick a category out of a hat. And Sunday at 8 p.m., return the finished film. Otherwise, you're disqualified. 48-hour film festival. So A Miss was that film. That was amazing. I picked a family film, and I made a beautiful little short film. I had it in my head. I wrote it all night, 9 o'clock in the morning. I already had my two actors, no matter what category I was going to do and write, because I'm not prolific as a writer. And it was only 11 people got their films in done. And I was sitting there after I got mine in 20 minutes before at the Cinedome on Sunset Boulevard. They were there with a table waiting for people to come in. And I got mine in and I said, I'm going to sit here the last 12 minutes and see if anybody just comes up. And sure enough, it's like the last minute. And this big heavy guy is running up with his film. And he's like running and running and running up to the table. And the guys go, that's it, it's over. He's like 10 feet from the table. He can't submit his film.
Oh.
He just sat down on the ground and started crying. But that was the rules.
Well,
he missed it by like 10 seconds.
Oh, that's
I said, come on, let the guy get his film in. And it's funny because A Miss didn't win any awards at that. But it went on to, they said it wasn't done very professionally. It's a beautiful film. It's funny. It's cute. It's really cute. And it went on to go to so many, like 20 film festivals. So, to them.
Okay. Well, you still got
like, Kelly, and hopefully I'll get a third one to Change That Bind real soon.
Okay. Well, tell us about Change That Bind.
The Change That Bind is, you would love it. I think it's still on Roku. I have to find out. But The Change That Bind is a beautiful story. I directed and produced it about a woman after a long marriage in her, like at 50 years old, 55 years old, coming back to the dating scene. It's cute. It's poignant. It's very timely and very sweet. And I'm really proud of it considering we shot the whole film in one day.
Oh,
yeah, it's a short. Yeah,
okay.
It's like a 13-minute short. I won five awards for it, five different film festivals, and it was at eight film festivals.
Yeah,
it's going to be at a Vegas film festival.
On the red carpet, you know, for that.
But moment. I don't think I want to ever go back to Vegas after that experience.
Okay, well, but, okay. So tell us about Oscar night.
It's a beautiful, it's not a real story. It's a made up story, but it's made in a way that everybody thinks that Oscar Knight is a real famous director from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. So after people have seen the film, it played around the world in 42 cities or something like that around the world, in Sicily and Greece and Austria and London and Paris. And it's going to be coming out soon, hopefully. It's about a fictitious Oscar Knight director.
Okay.
And I got real stars from the 50s, 60s, 70s. Not me, Scott. I was just an actor. Got real stars from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s to play themselves talking about working with Oscar Knight to sell the story.
Oh.
And in it, I play Reggie Leonardo, a A-list action actor star. So there's a film within the film too. And the whole thing is I get two Oscars. And Oscar Knight never got an Oscar. I remade one of his films from the 50s and I got an Oscar for it. And he was up for an Oscar and I beat him for the Oscar. Yet he's my mentor.
Okay.
So it's a real pungent biography about a fictitious director. And when everybody leaves the theater, they look on IMDb and go, where is this guy? I can't find anything on him because it's not real.
Okay.
So near myth, the Oscar Knight story. Beautiful. Yeah, I love that film. And Hollywood.con is, I love, that's the one I shot and then it premiered in Arkansas. That's coming out next week. Hollywood.con. And it's funny, all of a sudden I'm not playing bad guys anymore. I'm doing all these comedies that are real fun. I mean, Band President was fun. That was fun. I mean, it was hot. It was brutal, but it was fun anyway.
Okay, well, let's talk. First, let's talk about your relationship with Thomas Lai and the project that you have, if you can talk about it.
Yeah, I could talk a little bit about it. With Thomas now, we have a Chinese TV show, you know, backed by Chinese investors to premiere around the world. It's for the Chinese market and for the U.S. market and for the continent of Africa and for the continent of South America. And it's about, it's kind of like Dynasty times three. It's about three different families, an African family from Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So it takes, part of it takes place in Africa, but that part we're either going to shoot in Miami or LA, you know, in California. A Puerto Rican family that we're not going to shoot in Puerto Rico, we're either going to shoot in Miami or California. Mm-hmm. And a Chinese family that we are shooting in Beijing and Shanghai. And it's a big budget. And they're shooting right out a whole season, 12 episodes in the pilot. And it's going to be the Puerto Rican family speaks a lot in Spanish. And for whatever market, like for the Chinese market, it's all going to be in Mandarin with American subtitles. For the, no, it's going to be in the way it is with Mandarin subtitles. In the American market, it's going to be, have American subtitles for when they speak Chinese and when they speak Mandarin or when they speak Spanish. So it's pretty diverse, and there's so much money involved here that they're just buying their broadcast airtime so they don't have to deal with the network. Because I produced a Lifetime movie. I was a producer on a Lifetime movie once, and the network gets final say on who's in the cast, the stars. And on this particular film, I won't mention the name, but the network turned down Sam Elliott. They said, we don't approve of him in the film. We don't think he's good. I'm like, are you kidding me? Oh. Sam Elliott, Roadhouse.
Was this a long time?
So they approved Michael Norrie from Flashdance. But that was a trip. So, you know, getting approval, you can't go in with stars. You got to work with the network for them to approve stars. But in this particular case, you cast who we want. Not even stars, just good actors, because it's being done backwards. And what I mean by that is, this is the first time I'm a producer on anything where all we have is the money.
That's good.
You know what I mean? And putting the rest together. As an American, we can't go to China right now. So we're waiting until the mainland allows Americans to go in. And then I'm going to Shanghai and Beijing to meet the money people. There's nothing to close. It's all there. So, and Thomas and I are going to produce the U.S. segment of it. So that's where I'm going to try and bring you and Justin in on it. Also, I wanted to tell you, I didn't get a chance to tell you yet. Yesterday, I signed on to a new feature film, which I'm going to try and get you on to see if there's a role. I'm getting the script tonight. Shooting in Naples, Florida. And I already read the script and did a Zoom meeting on it about 3 months ago. And they just loved me as an actor. I have a great role in it. And I'm producing it. And it's called Inside. And it's done by my friend Georgia Menendez. Mendez. And she's a wonderful writer. Just a wonderful writer. She just had a feature film in its debut and just came out. And Inside the Butterfly Net. And what it's about is, it's a story of a woman who has to risk her daughter's life to save it. And she's and the mother is a professor, a major scientist in genealogy. It has to do with genes and DNA and stuff. It's a beautiful,
Wow.
touching story. Yeah, it's so good. All these last few years, it's so great to get away from the plane, the drug dealer, hitman, wife beater roles.
Robert is always working, but he's the nicest person I've met in show business, and he got me my role in Bad President. So let's talk about Bad President
You
now.
got your role in
What are
Bad
we
President. I
doing?
just introduced you to
What do we
him.
look for? No, Robert
But
is one of my best friends,
Zagman.
and he's an angel.
This is what I'm talking about.
So let's
Great
talk
work
about
again.
how you got
Good.
involved
Do
with
something
Bad
in this
President.
fucked up world. Do we have anybody that'll fit
Oh,
Dawna?
well, I was there
Kardashian sisters,
basically from the
witches.
beginning. Let's see now. Bad
I
President
don't
shot
belong
last year. I have to do this calendar
here.
thing.
Good.
Bad President shot
Listen,
last year over the
he's got
summer and
all three of the
fall.
key requirements. He's a narcissist.
Year
He's
before.
Machiavellian.
A
Year before,
psychopath.
I took a
Oh,
meeting through a
try it.
friend
And he wants to be president of the United States,
with
which will set a
Param,
new record
flew
for
down
growth. I
from
like it.
Desto, and I took a meeting at the
Ooh.
Sportsman's Lodge on a Saturday
Wow.
morning with my
Yeah.
friend, myself,
What's
Jeff
your name?
Olin, the
He's a
casting
fucking
director,
idiot for number one. He's perfect. He
and
has no
Param.
shame.
And
Number
Param
two,
talked about this
man.
low-budget
He's
film.
fouled
Would
the
I come
plate
on board
three
as a
times,
producer and
fouled
line
Captain
produce it?
11 times.
And we had a
Yet he
beautiful
raised two
breakfast,
sons
and
of
we
his own
talked.
to
And then,
shit. If he didn't have a rich father, this
about a
fool
month
wouldn't be
later,
out
I found out
there
that
working
the
at
money
Popeyes
fell out,
selling that
and
fucking
it
sandwich to
just kind
people.
of went
He's
away.
been the perfect candidate.
I
He
kind of
wants
in
to
a
be president of
relationship,
New
or at least I
York
thought
City.
I
And
was,
you, oh,
and that
you
kind of broke up, and I was on my way back
just
home to
platform
here in LA, and I was
idiots
pretty
and flowers
depressed.
eating cause.
And I said, "Oh my God, I just need something to get into in my career right now." And the phone rings, and it's Param, and he says, "We're doing the film in 3 weeks, so you're on board as a producer." So I go, "What do you need?" He told me this, this, and this, and that's how that happened. I mean, and then we kind of winged it once we got to Vegas. I thought everything was okay, and then we realized that there were a lot of, he let me know that there were a lot of roles we had to cast, so I had to cast it all from Vegas.
Okay.
I mean, not you and not Justin. The three minions were very important to the scene
Yeah,
of the
no,
whole
and Vegas
film.
is a great one. Well, the
Very
script was
important.
written by
It
John
was
Buchanan, right?
changed.
The script was.
Yes, and John passed away before we even went to pre-production. So,
Yeah.
but and Param, the both of them wrote the script. Param
Okay.
wrote it too.
Oh, okay. Well, John Buchanan was a real journalist who followed Trump, right?
Yeah, I don't know much about him. I really don't. I mean, all this was real until I landed in Vegas. I didn't know much what was going on. Then everything was like, "Here, let's do this. We're making a film." And I'm like, "Oy vey." But we got through it. I won't even talk about the strange and weird stuff that happened. And I'll just go on to say, yeah, well, you and I shot all of our scenes in the whole movie with Justin and Griffin in about 3 days, 4 days, was it?
It was 4 days. Yeah. And tell
And
our audience about Justin.
about Justin?
Yeah, because I know
Oh, my
he's a great
buddy
friend of
Justin.
yours.
Justin and I met. We were both, he was the chair of the Young Performers Committee at Screen Actors Guild before the merger, before it's this SAG-AFTRA thing. And I was on the board of directors, Hollywood Board of Directors of Screen Actors Guild. And he asked me to join the committee, and we became really good friends. And we kept in touch, and we always said, "We got to do something together." Now, for you people who don't know who Justin is, Justin was the kid on Picket Fences for 12 years. He grew up on that show, has an Emmy for it. But I guess a lot of you younger people will know him from either Erie, Indiana, which he had a show on, I think it was on ABC, or what's his car Saturday morning cartoon? Hey Arnold. Where he does one of the voices on Hey Arnold. So that's my buddy, Justin Shenkarow. Hey, Justin, I know you'll watch eventually. So we made a vow to each other on Bad President, didn't we? That we would get each other work. So
yeah,
that's what that's about.
It was a wonderful experience. We stayed at the Excalibur. Tell the audience about Eddie Griffin.
Oh, Eddie's a trip. I love Eddie. He's very, you know, to anybody who's seen the film, he kind of carries the film because he's so strong. He's such a strong actor. I mean, people know him as a stand-up comedian, but he's so strong in his role. And I mean, he played off that death. There was no talk, Luther.
Yeah, he was amazing. He's got.
Do you remember the notes Param gave us? Do you remember in that small room in that studio where we shot our scenes? All our scenes, by the way, everybody, were shot on green screen. Isn't that amazing the way they put everything in behind us and behind Eddie? But do you remember? I just keep remembering. The one thought that stays in my head is when we were in that little small room sitting in those little grammar school desks with the desk on top. It was really cool. And Param came in and he gave us notes of what to think for each of our characters before we went on doing our first scene.
Yeah.
That was nice because I, you know, telling us each what to keep in our head as misery and shame. And
Yeah, and then.
So Eddie, that stayed in my head more than anything.
Yeah, so Eddie gave us tickets to his show.
Oh boy, wasn't that fun? We were treated like royalty. Crystal champagne and mimosas and in his box. That was a fun night, wasn't it? I saw those pictures and stuff.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's an experience I'll never forget. Now tell us about Melani.
You were great too, you know. Now Jeff Rector played Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And I know he's going to kill me for this, but Jeff Rector is Trump.
He's so funny.
So he was perfect. I brought him in. I really blow it. Param had this younger kid who didn't have a big resume. I go, no. I mean, you well know when we shot those scenes that Eddie Griffin is really strong and very intimidating to work with. And you have to overpower that with your own intimidation and ability and craft and really dig deep to come up with a performance. Otherwise, you just are a burnt star. You dim compared to his shining.
I know his
so
eyes are
you
just
know that.
Glowing.
So Jeff, I knew Jeff would blow it out. And it wasn't a stretch for Jeff to play Trump. And he was only doing it on his webisode and good at it. So I said, I brought him in. And I mean, all through the shooting, he was Trump. You know, to Jeff Rector, he called me up and when this was coming out and he couldn't make the party. And he said that he loved your work in it. Best you ever did. And he was, you know, he hated to say that he was surprised how good you were.
Oh, well, that's a real compliment. Oh, well, thank you, Jeff.
You know, we created three different unique characters. We created three different unique characters in many ways, completely different from each other to be Eddie's Luther's minions. And we pulled that off. And I mean, it was hot. Remember, it was up to 130 degrees when they shut that air conditioning off.
Yeah.
It was hot as heck. We were shooting for 10 hours. You know, we had to sit really strong because it was CGI. It was going to be CGI, so we couldn't get up from those seats.
I mean, it
was tough, right? You were a trooper.
It was a great set because of all of you, you know. And I got to know, well, I already knew you, but I got to know you really well. Justin is amazing. And Melani came on to help you. You brought her on.
Yeah, and you met Melani, my good friend Melani.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Melani.
Yes.
She helped.
Her film right now is on Roku. I did her film. I play a hitman in it, 808. And it's been winning all the festivals lately, and it's still on Roku. It's on Roku for the Culver City Film Festival on Roku, where you go, you pay, I think, $3. You see all the films of the festival, Culver City Film Festival, and it's on something called the Short Show or something. So that Milani's a filmmaker. She's wonderful.
Yeah,
And
I saw
that's a
the film.
Hawaiian film that's set in Hawaii.
Yeah, it's great. Okay, now, Robert, where can people see Bad President? It is amazing. I mean, we saw it for the first time at
People
the
can see
premiere.
Bad President at the next party, at the next when this COVID goes over, we need to have a big screening in a big theater, if theaters still exist.
It
But
was
right
going to
now,
go
you
into
could see it on
theaters.
Amazon Prime. It was supposed to go to theaters before COVID.
I
Initially, when
know.
this first started, we were going to have a 3,000 theater release around the world. I think it might be in theaters in Japan right now. I'm not sure, but I know it's released in Japan, and I know they're working on Canada for release and Canada TV. So I'll let you know when that happens, but you'll probably find out before me. Paul seems to be more tuned than any of us.
Well, I have a friend in Canada who saw
But
it
you can see
before
it
it
on
was released.
Amazon Prime, on iTunes, on Vudu, and Google Play. You can go
Okay.
and see it. So
Okay.
it's
And
fun. It's a fun film.
please see it. It is hilarious. Jeff Rector is hilarious as Trump and amazing. And Eddie Griffin is like, a major star. I mean, he's so talented. I mean, he
Oh, he
was
is
having us
wonderful.
laugh. Yeah,
Yeah,
and
Malcolm and
Jeremy
Eddie had that
Rector.
TV show for years. Malcolm and Eddie. Yeah, I just want to thank Param. Param, you did. We did
Oh,
it. We did
he's
it, Param. We did such a. You did such a great job making this film. We went through so
amazing.
much, and it's not out in like we expected, but it's there, and people are loving it, and I'm proud of you, Param.
Well, it was a great experience, and thank you so much, Robert. Thank you, Param.
No, thank you, sweetie.
And Robert, I'll be seeing you again soon. So, thank you for guesting on
Yeah,
our
you
show
know I'm a
today.
I respect and honor you and love you so much. And what I respect about you probably most is your intelligence.
Thank you
So I
so
love
much.
you. I'm glad you worked in the film. We'll be doing many more. I'm gonna try and get you on everything I'm doing. Sometimes it's beyond my control, but I'll do my best, you and Justin. And yeah, that's it. Thank you for this today. This was wonderful.